going to present a paper entitled General Studies on the Material Culture of Prehistoric and Preliterate People. Now, coming to the introductory part, prehistory is a branch of anthropology which deals with the remains of past human culture and civilization. The term prehistory was first introduced in English language in 1851 by Daniel Wilson. However, the term was used even 20 years before. Scholars like Lubbock, Tyler, Gladstone, and Pigott made useful contributions in the kind of study. This presentation attempts to make a brief general study of the material culture of prehistoric and preliterate people of the world. Now let us move to the another point, material culture of prehistoric people. The ecology of man is heavily influenced by technology and its material products. In contrast to that of the living beings, material culture refers to the sum of the artifacts resulting from technology. Animals simply utilize the material environment for food and shelter, changing it relatively little in the process. Whereas, man alters or transforms his environment by making tools of wood, stone, shell, bone, and metal to increase his efficiency in using and controlling environment. Artifacts are the main material remains of prehistoric culture. They are conceived and made for use by human beings only. On the other hand, these are used to draw inferences on the life and style and food habit of the early man. Artifacts are used as evidences of the evolutionary development and adaptation of man to the environment. They are categorized on the basis of their function. Different items like stone, clay, and pottery, wood, ivory, bone, metal, etc., can be classified on the basis of the material in which they are made. Now turn to the another material known as stone. Stone is the first material used by men for making tools, implements, and some other objects of daily use in prehistoric time. The next material is clay and pottery. Clay vessels and other utensils, beads, toys, figurines, etc., have been excavated from many sites of prehistoric periods in different parts of the world. Clay was certainly an important discovery among man's earliest discoveries of natural material. Pottery is also an important indicator of cultural life, because making of pottery is related to the higher accomplishment of primitive people. Next point is wood. Wood is an organic material and has been used since the early days of Stone Age. It has also been used for making various kinds of weapons, objects of daily use, as well as materials for art and decoration. The oldest wooden implements recovered is wooden spear point, about 200,000 years old. Next come to another raw material, ivory and bone. The use of ivory and bone were recognized since the Upper Paleolithic period. Ivory was the most common raw material for making implements, ornaments, handles for weapons, beads, etc. Both ivory and bone can be easily seen because they are porous in nature. Now come to the next material, metals. Apart from gold and silver, mass work of copper, bronze and iron objects has been discovered as exhibits of bronze and iron ages. The prehistoric people made many items from copper and bronze during that period. The first or the oldest prehistoric culture is known as Paleolithic or the Old Stone Age. The term comes from the Greek word paleos, means old, and lithos means stone. Paleolithic period or Old Stone Age is very important as it provides a clear-cut sequence of cultural development throughout the entire Pleistocene time all over the world. In this time, stone is used as tool in the way of life of prehistoric people because all the peoples of this time were hunters and gatherers. Paleolithic can be further divided into three cultural phases. They are Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic, and Upper Paleolithic. Now, let's turn to the Lower Paleolithic cultural phase. This time span of Lower Paleolithic was the maximum, covering the whole of Lower Pleistocene and bulk of the Middle Pleistocene epoch. The stratigraphic sequences of entire Pleistocene epoch containing Lower Paleolithic artifacts have been discovered from the Somme Valley in the North France and Thames Valley in the South England. Then, tool-making traditions of Lower Paleolithic in Western Europe can be divided into two groups, such as the core industry and the flag industry. The stone is the only material of these two industries of prehistoric period. Now turn to core industry. The elementary feature of the core industry is the bifacial tool. That means more or less pointed tool made on core where both the upper and the lower surfaces are worked. This industry is subdivided into two subtypes or traditions, such as Abibalian and Acheulean. Typologically, very crude type of chopers, chopping tools, scrapers, hand edges, hand axes, etc. are included in this group. During the first glacial period, that is Gunes, this industry flourished in Western Europe and Africa. Now turn to next industry known as flag industry. The flag industry of Lower Paleolithic culture has two traditions. They are number one, the Clactonian tradition, and number two, the Levalloan tradition. Now come to the Clactonian tradition. The Clactonian flags are rough and struck out and systematically from a unprepared core. It is suggested that most of these flags are produced by striking the lump on the edge of an anvil. The Clactonian flags generally exhibited large, massive, unfaceted striking platforms and prominent bulbs of percussion. Now come to the Levalloan tradition. It is predominantly represented by flag tools, which are produced by using Levalloan tool making technique. It requires a careful preparation of the core. The flags are detached from the specially prepared cores. This flag tradition is found well in Western Europe, Africa, and India. Now turn to next cultural phase. Middle Paleolithic. In the Middle Paleolithic cultural phase, the core tool industry have totally been transferred to the flag industry. It is marked by the large number of side scrapers, back knives, points, nose flags, burines, and scraper. The geological age of this culture is Middle Pleistocene, and human race is Neanderthal people. Now turn to the next cultural phase, Upper Paleolithic. The last part of the Paleolithic culture gave rise to the Upper Paleolithic phase. During this short span of time, diversified and specialized tools made on blades were shown by the replacement of the core and flag tools of the earlier phases. Bone was also taken as a material for making tools. This phase has been referred to as osteodontokeratic cultural phase for the utilization of bone, teeth, and horn at a time. Early men of primitive types disappeared at this cultural phase, and the men of modern type came into existence. The cultural stage also shows the beginning and flowering of the Paleolithic earth. Now we are moving to blade and burine industry. The blade and burine industry of Upper Paleolithic comprises three traditions, namely the Aurignacian, Solutrean, and Magdalenian. The characteristic tools are blades of flint with one edge straight, razor-like. The hunters possibly used these blades as knife in this period. This industry is represented by the flint, burine, tang points, gravity points, multi-angle gravers, etc. Another important cultural stage is Mesolithic. It is another important culture that began at the end of Pleistocene, but at the beginning of the Holocene. A change primarily affected the people of advanced Paleolithic culture. In that time, climate was gradually changed. The weather in temperate latitude got warmer, whereas it became drier in Mediterranean and subtropical zones. Men had to adapt themselves to quite novel conditions. The cultural development of Mesolithic has been observed in Europe. The people altered their food pattern and changed tool technology. Flints are turned to pygmy tools called microliths. Microliths are characteristic tool of Mesolithic people. These are extremely minute, some measurements only 3 by 16 inches or even less in size. Such microliths were used to be hafted in rows to act as knife. Mesolithic people invented a wonderful device for killing of mammals, that is, bow and arrow. The Mesolithic people in Europe mostly live in caves or in rock shelters. The most significant development of Mesolithic people were domestication of animals such as dog, invention of pottery, and the bow and arrow. All these became more important in later period, that is Neolithic. Now turn to Neolithic culture. It is a Greek word. It means new stone age. The period since the discovery of agriculture to the rise of urban civilization has been bracketed as new stone age or Neolithic period. During Neolithic period, stone objects were manufactured by packing, chipping, grinding, rubbing, or polishing technique. In this period, men became a food producer. Food collecting people completely rejected their nomadic life and started settled village life. They started using trunks of trees, With ware used to tie several logs of wood together to make a raft, and that was used as a means of transport. New types of stone tools were produced by using grinding and polishing technique. They also used flag implements made of flint. These tools were fitted into a wooden handle to be used as awl, salt, gravel, saw, sickle, etc. The practice of fishing was also improved during this period. People settled down in villages and tried to invent ways to make life easier. These are invention of wheel, invention of handmade and wheel-made pottery, invention of weaving, building of huts and dwelling complexes, manufacturing of dugout canoes, boats, and development of social organization, domestication of plants and animals, etc. All these made them possible to rise to a status of literate civilization. B. Gordonsile mentioned that Neolithic age had opened an entire new way of life, and he termed it as Neolithic Revolution. Now come to another topic, material culture of preliterate people. Man has always depended on three resources for his survival, such as physical environment, culture, and population. The purely hunting-gathering group depended totally on bounties of nature. Prehistoric men were totally food-gatherers, hunters, fishermen, and fowlers. Food-gathering hunting techniques vary from region to region and from society to society according to the local environmental conditions. The custom, tradition, and value system of different society are not alike. Besides, typically food-gathering hunting societies, one comes across several food-producing societies resorting to gathering to supplement their food requirements. Human societies living by food-gathering and hunting did not possess containers or utensils. The tools and implements at the disposal of the gatherer-hunters were so crude that the output in terms of quantity of food produced was usually too meager. Gradually, man developed his technology. Thus, the crude hand axes and choppers gave way to blade and flat tools. Then he also made throwing weapons like throwing club, bow and arrow, spear, harpoons for fishing, noose and traps for hunting. The existing gathering hunting societies of the world use throwing weapons for hunting like nets, traps, and pets like dogs and hawks, etc. are used in hunting expeditions. Nets of various types, noose, and traps are also used by different human groups. Fishing has also been an important aspect of gathering hunting economy. Various types of harpoons, hooks, and rods were used for fishing. Various techniques of fishing mainly depended upon the local environmental conditions. Some of the prevalent fishing methods are fishing by hands, fishing by poisoning, fishing by stopping the flow of water over a patch of land, fishing by weapons, fishing by nets. Men started becoming familiar with fire and later learned making his food tastier by mixing vegetables and spices. During Neolithic times, the following fire-making techniques have been used by several primitive societies. Number one, fire making by friction. Pieces of rocks, wood, bamboo, or any metals are ground against each other till it generates heat. Number two, fire making by blow. It involves a blow of any hard material like rock over another similar material. Shelter or habitation is always one of the primary needs of man. The nature of housing was related with the local environmental factors, like the availability of raw material. Man used nature, made shelters like rock shelter, caves, bushes, and trees. All human groups make houses according to the locally available resources. Thus, we found mainly four types of houses. Number one, rock shelter or caves. Number two, hilly slopes. Number three, huts. And number four, snow houses. Mobility has been an integral part of human activities. Moving from one place to another place for exploring avenues for food and other means of survival may be regarded as the basic and most popular reason of mobility. Domesticated animals had been used in various economic activities, including transport. Men also used to ride such animals for the safety of the goods, as well as to avoid the drudgery of working over long distances in difficult geographical terrains. Use of dog over icy surface, buffaloes, ponies, and elephants in plains, camels in desert regions, and mammals like reindeer and yaks in the mountain regions have helped a lot. Men devised boats and canoes to move on water. Painting the body is considered as the oldest method of personal adornment and is still practiced by many primitive societies of the world. Painting was used as human decoration, lotion for protecting against insect bites, frightening their enemies, and also for signs of mourning. Primitive tribes of Andaman and Nicobar Islands are good examples. The practice of tattooing has been prevalent among the primitive as well as modern societies. Ornaments are one of the most popular and oldest ways of personal adornment. The popular motifs behind ornamentations are its use as a prophylactic against the evil spirits, to improve personal appearance, and to attract opposite sex through the enhancement of sexual appeal. Now let's come to the concluding part of this paper. In this lecture, an attempt has been made to give a brief report on the material culture of prehistoric and preliterate people of the world. It has been shown that the ecology of man is quite different from that of other living beings in the world, because man has been deeply influenced by technology and industry which were used for material products. Technology and industry is the sum total of the techniques, poses, and used by members of human society. Artifacts have been left by those ancient human beings, and these artifacts have been used by the scholars to draw inferences on the lifestyle and food habits of early men and to note the evolutionary development and adaptation of humans to the environment. This study has referred to some of the important artifacts left by the early men. In this way, an attempt has been made to refer to various types of technology and industry of the prehistoric and preliterate people of the world.